Hi, this is Jeff Rouse, executive producer of Our Story Productions. We're just getting ready to shoot some new shows of Martin County on TV. We haven't shot any for a while because of the coronavirus. We're glad to be back. Hope you enjoy the new shows. Some of the ones we're going to be showing in the near future will be from before the virus and some after. We hope you enjoy them all.
Well, hello everybody. It's Blake Potthoff here with Martin County on TV, and you might have not seen me for a while, so it's nice to see all of you again. I'm the executive director at the Fairmont Opera House, and I'm guest hosting on Martin County TV every once in a while. And today I'm with one of my favorite people in all of Fairmont. Miss Sarah from St. John Vianney is here with us again today. She's making a return trip. Now, I didn't speak with her last time, so I've got lots of questions. So I want to talk today about all the stuff that's changed and the new exciting things. So what is St. John Vianney doing coming up this year?
So we're really excited to announce that we will be open for in-person school on August 31st, which
good.
I think a lot of people will be
good.
Excited about.
Yes, very exciting.
So we learned, I think we all learned that distance learning was really difficult for our students and for our parents. So the bishops of Minnesota, along with the superintendents of each of the dioceses, got together to formulate a plan for how we can best serve our students. And our plan is to be in person starting August 31st with our preschool through sixth grade students with safety precautions in place, of course. Our biggest thing is to make sure that our kids are safe and that my teachers are safe, but the best place for them is in the building with each other.
Yes.
So we're really excited about all of this.
That's very, very exciting. So August 31st is the start date. So what kind of new things can students at St. John Vianney, and maybe teachers too, if you wanted to talk about it, what can we anticipate this coming year?
So I think that we're going to try to make school look as normal as possible, which is different from some of our other schools in the area. We want to make sure that our kids are in the building with their teachers, with their classmates, with their friends, because we've learned that not only is academic education really important, but being together as the family that we are at St. John Vianney, that's really important too. And our kids are missing that. And so we're going to start school like we normally would. There will be obviously safety precautions in place, like extra hand sanitizing. We're gonna be teaching and reteaching, I'm sure, the kids how to wash their hands properly, making sure that social distancing is taking place when need be. We're going to make whatever changes we have to make within our building to make sure that we keep everybody safe.
Well, it's so wonderful to hear about how things are progressing forward. Because it's such a different and unusual time that we've all been through. And from the outside looking in, St. John Vianney has done such a wonderful job. You know, distance learning, yes, was very difficult, but it seems like St. John Vianney didn't miss a step. So I want to commend you for that, because it's not easy. I'm married to a teacher, and I know how difficult that can be. So I want to say thank you for what you're doing for our community and doing for the kids in our community, because it is very important. One of the things I wanted to ask you about, the educational impact is what you're talking about. And being somebody who runs a theater and interacting with people all the time, we talk about the social interactions as well. Mm-hmm. So how do you see the school as serving some of those things that are missing? You know, for a long time, kids were at home and not interacting with their peers. There's so much knowledge to be shared and gained through interaction socially. So how excited are you to get back into that kind of regular swing of things, if you will, that kids get to interact with their friends again and build those relationships? Could you expand on that, what that means to you?
Yep. Well, I think that one of the biggest things that draws people to our school is that when you walk into our building, it feels like you are part of a family. And being within that family structure each day is so important to our kids. They love to be with their classmates. The preschoolers love to hang out with the sixth graders and vice versa. And they build these relationships that last for years and years and years, which is really, really neat. We're going to do things, you know, obviously to keep the kids safe, but just them being together and being able to talk with one another when it's not on Facebook Messenger, Kids, and all those different programs that are on a phone or on a computer. They need that social face-to-face interaction, and to be able to not only help their emotional and mental health, but being together helps develop all these different kinds of skills that they don't get when they're at home. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, absolutely. Seeing kids interact, we see it with children's theater, mm-hmm. when kids interact with one another and play with one another, mm-hmm. there's so much growth and development in a natural, almost unstructured way, right. Through physical things such as playing on the playground, yeah. or just passing people in the hallway, learning how to interact with one another. So from my perspective, it's so wonderful to see people getting back to that, mm-hmm. to say, like, we want to be safe about everything, mm-hmm. and we can be safe about everything, but we have to give kids specifically this interaction that they really need and they thrive on. And so I have a question about what that might look like. Do you think there's going to be a bit of a deficit in returning, or do you think kids are going to be so ready for it that you won't see a difference? Is the excitement going to be so, mm-hmm. I would be over the moon to see my friends again after so much time. And I just think that it's so important to get kids back together. Do you think that will be the response, that everybody's just so excited that it, even though we've missed so many steps and missed so many mm-hmm. beats and apart for so long, that the level of excitement is just so high?
My hope is that we can just pick up right where we left off. Mm-hmm. So back in March, when schools had to close, our last day of in-person class was March 17th. Mm-hmm. That weekend before, my teachers and I met late into the evening to plan how are we going to do this. So we did not take those 8 days off that a lot of schools did mm-hmm. for planning. When our kids left on Tuesday, they had what they needed to start in distance learning on Wednesday. So there was no break at all, which was really nice because the teachers could teach them on that Monday and Tuesday, this is what we expect, this is what you have to do, and the kids were ready to go. And it was also helpful to the parents because the kids just got into a routine at home right away. So academically, will there be things that we need to catch up on? Of course, for mm-hmm. sure. But I have a really strong feeling that most of our students academically are just gonna pick up right where they left off. And my hope is that they're so excited to get to school that we have to kind of tame them down a little
bit. Absolutely.
So.
And I think it's interesting that you say that you know, you're picking up right where you left off. And mm-hmm. if my memory serves me right, I remember the first part of school, we reviewed stuff from the past year anyway.
Right.
So it's encouraging to hear that you're not losing a whole bunch of steps.
Right.
I think that's such an important thing moving forward, is that St. John Vianney, your students didn't lose 6 months or 3 months or whatever. They hopped right into this distance learning, and it became so natural to them that they just picked right up. And then you go back in the school year again, mm-hmm. just doing the same thing you would have anyway. That's very impressive.
Right. And I think that when people come to St. John Vianney, they know that there's a high academic standard that's mm-hmm. going to be required of their students. So we are able to set the tone while they're in the building that these are what the expectations are. And the kids come to school wanting to learn. And that's something that you don't find everywhere else. Mm-hmm. And it's something that our teachers are so passionate about, making sure that our kids, at the end of the school year, they know everything that they need to know, that sets us aside from other places. We have a lot of really good schools in our area that serve our students very well, but we just have something really, really special where we're at. We can focus in on these really important academic needs, plus we're able to give the kids a really good moral foundation because the expectations are high, and they're high from the beginning. That starts in preschool. It's not something that we wait until they're in third or fourth grade to begin.
Right.
So they have this academic achievement. They have this good moral foundation. So we know when they leave us, they're ready to make really good choices. And my goal is to provide these academic needs for them, to give them that moral foundation, and to give them the tools that they need to use the gifts that God has given them while they're here on earth. But then when their time to move on has come, mm-hmm. that they're on the right path to heaven.
Yep.
And if I can do that, I have succeeded.
The most powerful thing that I see from all of your students that I've worked with and you've brought to the Opera House is that they're good people and they enjoy being together.
Thank you. I appreciate that. You know, we can't tell what the future is going to hold. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow or next mm-hmm. week or a month from now, but I know when August 31st rolls around, our kids are going to be in the building. They're going to be happy. Our teachers are going to be excited to see them. And I am just like so excited for that time because we just need to be together. Mm-hmm. That's really important for all
of us. I totally
agree.
Totally agree. Well, August 31st is rapidly approaching. So how do we get in contact with you to enroll the kids at St. John Vianney?
Yep. So you can call the school office and set up a tour. I'm happy to give people tours. If you want to meet a specific teacher, we can make that happen. And this is a really simple registration process. There's just a couple of pieces of paperwork to fill out. So phone number, email, Facebook page, all of those things have all the information that people need.
And just search for St. John Vianney and that'll pop right up on Facebook?
Yep.
Wonderful. Well, it's been such a pleasure to see you again, to speak with you about all these wonderful things that are happening here at St. John Vianney and here on Martin County TV. We want to thank all of you for tuning in. It's been such a wonderful experience to see you, and I'm so proud of the work that you're doing here in Fairmont. I'm glad I get to be a part of it as well.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, and you just are glowing. It's just so much fun. Talking about the kids and all this wonderful stuff, just you can feel the love and the energy that you have for all those students. So it's so very wonderful. Thank you so much. I needed it today.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, viewers, for checking in Martin County on TV. And well, before we go, now we'll go and do some of our historical tour stuff. So I don't want to leave before, you know, leading you into that. So I want to say thank you, but then make sure you're staying tuned because we have a little segment for you right here at the end. So this is Blake Potthoff, Executive Director of the Fairmont Opera House, guest host for Martin County on TV today. I thank you so much for tuning in. And now make sure you check out this segment. It's really, really good.
Martin County on TV Flashback.
Welcome back to Hometown Focus. I am with Jennifer Tao, who heads up the children's reading program at the Martin County Library in Fairmont. And she gets to do something I think is really great, and that is turning kids on to books. Thanks so much for being with us, Jennifer.
You're welcome.
Tell me a little bit about the children's reading program here.
Well, there's different aspects to it, but the main one is where kids come in and keep track of the time they spend reading, and they get different prizes for that. And then we also have programs here at the library where they can come in and I'll read to them, or we'll have activities that have to do with books.
Who can join or who can be part of this program?
Basically, it's kids from age 3 through grade 6, although we will let older kids in if they desire to be part of it.
And do you think it benefits even those little three-year-olds? Do you think it's a benefit to all of them, or sort of what's your take on who gets the most out of this program?
I think it benefits all the kids. The younger kids are read too instead of reading themselves, but I think that gets the parents involved in reading to them and brings them into the library, gets them familiar with the library. And of course the older kids, it's good to keep them reading over the summer, so they benefit too.
Do you find that the kids, especially the older kids that are reading already, does this sort of help hone their skills a little bit? Do you find that maybe at the start of the program, at the end of the program versus the start, they're maybe a little bit better at what they came here to do in the first place?
Hopefully they are. There is research that shows if kids don't read over the summer, they lose some of their skills. So we're hoping they at least keep the skills that they have. And we have some real go-getters that read a lot, and I'm sure that they improve their skills.
And that leads me to my next question, was who comes here? I mean, what are the kind of kids that you see here? Is it the bookworms, or is it all kinds of kids? And what's your makeup of your kids here?
We do see the kids that really like to read come in a lot and get a lot of books and read a lot of hours. But we also see the kids that need to have some remedial reading. This year we're cooperating with Lincoln School, and some of the kids that need to get more points in the accelerated reading program at Lincoln School have been coming in, and it's good to see them finding books and finishing that program as well as doing ours.
How important do you think it is to these kids with the points and marking down their books and getting how many they can get in during the summer? Is that a really, you think that's a positive aspect? Does it keep them going? Is it a fun part of the whole program?
That's what we hope, that it's a fun part. I know some kids don't need that incentive to do it. They would probably be reading anyway, but we're hoping that that just adds to the fun of it, to the enjoyment, kind of gives them something to work for and look forward to. Our final prize is a paperback book that they get free. And so that's kind of nice to think that they'll have their own book when they finish the program.
Do you find that the kids after the program feel more comfortable when they come into the library? Do they kind of act like they own the place once they get going here?
I think they do. It's nice when they know me and some of the other librarians here, where they feel comfortable asking questions, asking for help with different things, and also just know where things are, kind of come in and talk to us. That's nice.
Do you see that the kids that have gone through the program, do you tend to see them more than throughout the year once they've been through the program? Do their faces pop up here a little more often?
I notice the ones that are in my activity groups, that I see them and they say hello to me, and that's kind of neat. We do have about 250 kids signed up, so sometimes it's hard to know them all and which ones have been part of the program, but it is nice that when I go places in the community, I'll see kids that say hi to me, and that's a neat aspect of the reading program.
Well, you're the famous, you know, library lady, I suppose, right?
Yeah, sometimes it seems like that. I feel like a celebrity, so that's kind of fun.
I see you'll have your own float in the parade next year, and you can wave and, you know, throw books out to everybody. Tell me a little bit about, you know, you must love doing this, but do you have a focus? Do you have kind of a goal for yourself and for the kids throughout this program?
We try to get as many kids involved as possible. That's one of the goals. Try to get as many of the kids that sign up to finish. Our goal is to read 15 hours over 9 weeks, which isn't a lot for some kids, but which is quite a bit for others. So to have them reach that goal. Also, like we were talking, get as many kids into the library as possible over the summer.
When you get those little kids in here, like the 3 and 4 year olds who really can't read yet, for the most part, but just obviously just love having stories read to them, is that kind of your, do you like that? Is that sort of your favorite part?
That is a fun part. I do preschool story times during the year too, and so I see preschool kids all through the year, and that is really neat. They love to be read to. They love that, the activities that we do that go along with the books, and so it's a lot of fun.
I know that when I read to my 3-year-old, at first it might be kind of tough to pull them away from the TV, but once they start seeing the pictures in the book and hearing the story, they're just enthralled. And would you agree that it is so important at that age to get them going right away in books? And this is a great program for that.
Right. Yeah, the earlier you can get them involved in books, the more impact it has. And use their imagination, you know, in looking at the pictures and listening to the stories. So I think it's real beneficial.
Mm-hmm. Now, you said you do story time. You do that throughout the year, and I know you do things with the older kids, too. What's the most fulfilling part of this program for you?
Well, that's kind of hard to say. Working with the grade school kids is great in the summer, to get those older kids in. And I do a little book talk where I tell them about different books available that they can check out, and to see them get excited and want, kind of almost fight over the books, I want them to check them out. That's really neat.
Yeah, that would be neat to see kids actually fighting over books. And, you know, the new Harry Potter book just came out. And has there been excitement and buzz in the reading program about that?
Yes, we did have a Harry Potter pizza party in April, and there was a lot of kids that were really excited. And now we're trying to rush our new book out so it's available, and they've been asking about it. So,
sure. What's your take on the Harry Potter books? Do you think they're a good form of literature for the kids?
I think they're good fantasy books. If kids and parents like that kind of stories, they're great imagination books, really good writing, and I've read the first two, and they're a lot of fun.
Yeah, they're kind of the Star Wars for this generation in a way, aren't they?
Yeah, right. Kind of a whole different world, kind of fun to imagine.
Yeah, where they can make believe and dress up and do all of those things, and I find that interesting. If a 12-year-old or 11-year-old's buying a 700-page book, that writer's done a good job.
Yeah, that's right. This newest one is very fat. So it's neat that kids are willing to read those books.
Now, if you had a wish list, Jennifer, for your program, and I know that's kind of tough, but tell me briefly, what's some of the things you'd put on that wish list for this children's reading program?
Boy, that is tough. We always solicit donations for our paperback books that we give as prizes, and so the more money we have available there, the nicer books we can get for the kids. We give out prizes, and we do pay for that through the library, but it's always fun to have things that kids really, really look forward to getting. And then just to have the parents and the kids come in and and be part of it and come to the library over the summer.
More money and more involvement, right?
Right.
That'll always help. Thanks, Jennifer, for being with us today. Well, the Martin County Library certainly has a lot to offer, and that's in no small part due to the Friends of the Library, and that's the Friends of the Martin County Library. It's an organization that gets together and raises funds to buy items that aren't normally in the regular library budget. I have one of those good friends with me right now, Gil Picken, who is going to talk to us a little bit about what you all do for this library. Tell me first, Gil, why did you get together? What was the purpose of getting this group together?
Well, this group started, I think, in about 1968. Mm-hmm. That was the year before I came here as director. Mm-hmm. And the impetus at the time, there used to be a county library and a city library, and they needed to be together. Mm-hmm. And some of the impetus for the Friends group was provided by this endeavor there. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of interest. And then they decided to, yes, to form a county library and to build this building that was built in 1969 here. And, mm-hmm. So there was a lot of interest in the library in those days. And and then the Friends got started, and the Friends helped in various ways over the years. But we've sort of developed now into a group that helps with the book sale each year, gets rid of the discards, mm-hmm. and collects donations from people who want to mm-hmm. get rid of some books that are saleable yet. Mm-hmm. And then we use that money for various purposes. Mm-hmm. But the Friends group is still... although it may not be as active as it was back in those early years, mm-hmm. It's still a group that is basically interested in seeing that we have good library service mm-hmm. here in Martin County. And of course there's the library board that supervises the work of the director and the staff and the county commissioners who appoint the library board. But still, we're more of an independent group, just people who like libraries, mm-hmm. and we want to be darn sure that there's a good library here.
And absolutely, and it sounds like the group has evolved a little bit over the years. Your purposes and reasons for being here have changed, and that's evolved with what the needs of the library have been.
Yes, we used to do a lot more fundraisers, and we had we'd have dinner meeting at our annual meeting each mm-hmm. year, and there was a lot of people that were interested in the things that we were doing and supporting. The things that we do may not be that obvious.
Yeah, tell me a little bit about some of the things that you purchase here. I think maybe people don't know sort of what your work has brought about in this library.
Some of the things I think that are useful for the Friends are not the thing that the library would regularly be spending its funds for, but to be able to do something a little different and having something a little better. Okay. For example, when we decided to get into an art print collection, the Friends had some money to start that. And they charged a fee for it, and gradually it became self-supporting. But but to experiment and get it started in an art print collection, we helped with that. And also then we got into use of the internet on computers. Mm-hmm. The Friends helped to buy some of the equipment to get started so that sure. there'd be a public access mm-hmm. computer. And then things like a new circulation desk over the years, we helped with that. Right now we're thinking, we've been planning for some years now to add some lounge furniture. Mm-hmm. We need some better, more comfortable mm-hmm. lounge furniture. Mm-hmm. Furniture. Now, the library's responsibility, of course, is to provide furniture. Mm-hmm. But if you have nicer furniture and more comfortable furniture, then the Friends can help in that regard.
And more people come in to read because they've got a comfortable place to sit.
Right. Right now, a cool place to sit.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now, we're standing amongst a lot of books here. This is one of your biggest fundraisers, isn't it, the yearly book sale? Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, each year, as you can see, a lot of things accumulate. Mm-hmm. We weed them out of the collection. People give them to us. And they may already have, and some of them go into the collection, but if we've already got what we need in the collection, then they go here. And then we have this usually once a year. We'll sell the books starting at 50 cents and down to probably a nickel on the last day.
And I've been looking around in here, Gil. You've got everything. I mean, from A to Z. You got bonsai books, you got, you know, summer romances, you got everything. So it'll be a good sale. And I bet, you know, something like that takes a lot of work. Are you always looking for new friends of the library?
Right. We've got, you know, a regular group of about 50 members, but some of them just life members who support us. But when we need some, we always need some help at the book sale. And people who, in fact, there is a membership to the Friends. It's $3 a year or $5 for 2 years, mm-hmm. and you can get a life membership for $25. But if somebody doesn't want to pay that, we'll gladly substitute a few hours of working at the book sale, you know, for the cost of the membership.
Well, I know you're a great friend of the library. You obviously, you were the director here a while back and became another friend in a different way. We appreciate your time today. I hope the book sale goes well. Thanks.
Thank
again.
You.
Thanks.
Well, instead of Travis talk today, we have a little surprise. And it's been really hard to do this since Janet is around all the time. But our executive producer, Janet Ruth, is retiring.
She's going to call her quits after, I think it is 5 years, starting this program.
6 years almost?
From
six
scratch.
Years.
6 years?
She's telling me 6 years.
There was absolutely nothing here. She set up the thing with the school to work and the kids helping out. And
she created everything. Focus on Fairmont, hometown. Everything you've seen is basically because of her. And she's moving on to some other things now.
Things change, including Janet.
I know. She's going to eat bonbons. Oh, we got a roll. We won't get her package in.
Roll the tape.
So let's see it.
Look how Janet's changed.
Hi, I'm Janet Ruth. Welcome to our pilot show of Focus on Fairmont. On this program, you will be meeting guest reporters who will introduce you to interesting people and topics.
Well, good morning, Janet. Thanks for the invitation to be here today.
As Roger said, they have a good time. In fact, it isn't often that they encounter serious storms or emergencies. He said it's kind of like driving in southern Minnesota. Most of the time, the weather is pretty good. But every once in a while, you encounter some trouble.
It's also tough, John.
Roger, we're about 50 miles west of you, but having heavy sleet, rain, snow combination, visibility is so bad that we're a whole shoe waiting for an improvement. And just wondered what your situation was, over.
This is an exciting day for me. I'm going to take my first ever motorcycle ride. I've got the jacket, the boots, the helmet. Now all I need is my Harley and some advice. The guests have arrived and now it's time to party. See you in 2 weeks when we will again focus on Fairmont.
Martin County on TV Flashback.
Well, there you have it, another episode of Martin County on TV. We hope you enjoyed this episode and we welcome you to tune in again. Thank our sponsors for making this happen. And remember, it's not just the past, but the present that tells our story.